Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, brothers and sisters. Welcome to another episode of Sapient Thoughts, where we discuss theophilosophical issues, where we answer contentions about Islam or against Islam, and we provide a strong, robust case for the veracity of Islam. In today's episode, which is one of a multi-part series on beauty and the recognition of God, in this episode, we're going to be continuing where we left off last time. And if you remember, last time we had discussed the idea of beauty being connected to meaning. In today's episode, we're going to now come back to the issue of beauty being in the eyes of the beholder. In other words, is all beauty subjective? Now, just to remind ourselves, what is the central thesis? What is the point of these episodes? Where are we going? What are we trying to show? Remember, the idea was that exposure to beauty can allow someone to see truth as it really is. So that was the central thesis. And remember, we said that this happens by way of us putting forth the idea that when one is exposed to beauty, that increases their cognition and decreases their ego. Now, the subject for today is the idea of beauty itself, whether it's subjective or objective. Because if we were to say that beauty is subjective, then that would go against, that would be antagonist to the concept we are putting forth, or the thesis that we are presenting, rather. And that is that beauty can have an effect on a person such they can see truth as it really is. Because if it's subjective, that goes against that idea. However, if it's objective, then we can see that indeed it may actually be true that if someone is exposed to beauty, that they can then see truth as it really is. So let us now speak about this. First and foremost, we can divide beauty into two categories. You have beauty that comes by way of a human work. So whether that beauty is related to a painting, a picture, a composition of art of some sort, a drawing, music, poetry, this would be in the category of man-made art, or man-made beauty rather. And so in this category, we have man-made beauty. In the second category, we could say there is natural beauty that's part of the natural world. So things like the ocean and mountains and waterfalls and things like that. Now in these two broad categories, what we can see, or what we're putting forth, is that when it comes to man-made beauty, this indeed is subjective. This is where beauty lies in the eyes of the beholder. However, when it comes to natural beauty, this would indeed be objective, in the sense that when someone gazes at the beauty, they understand, and we understand this not subjective, but it's objectively beautiful. Now, why is that the case? Well, we say that that's the case because there is a way of understanding the difference between man-made beauty and natural beauty. And just as an example, if you were to see a picture of the Niagara Falls, right? And you saw, let's say, a picture or a painting of Niagara Falls, and then you were to go to the Niagara Falls yourself. And of course, we're talking about the Canadian side. The American side, maybe not so much, right? So you go to the Canadian side of Niagara Falls, and you experience it firsthand. Now, there's a type of beauty you may find in the painting or the artwork that represents the Niagara Falls, but then there's the experience of going to the Niagara Falls. So let's compare and contrast between the two. When we look at a painting or a picture of the Niagara Falls or of nature in general, we see that first and foremost, there is framing, right? So when someone has taken a picture, there's a certain boundary to that particular picture. Or when someone has painted, let's say the Niagara Falls, it is placed in a frame. Maybe not direct, let's say there is no direct frame, but there's framing that happens. There's a limitation, there's a spatial limitation. When you compare that to the natural world, we see that there is no framing. In fact, it is vast and open and endless. So right there and then you see two things that are very different between man-made beauty and natural beauty. The second thing is that when we consider the picture or the painting of the Niagara Falls, we understand that there's a human angle or a human bias. Our discussion, remember, started off with cognitive biases, and this is where we're, in a sense, returning back to that. So when a person paints the Niagara Falls, or they take a picture of the Niagara Falls, this is from a very specific angle or bias, meaning that the person has decided, and that's based on the person who's taking the picture or person that's doing the painting, that this is the angle that I'm going to take the picture, or this is the angle at which I'm going to paint the picture. Now, there could be a multitude of angles that the person chose, but it's the choice of the artist, and therefore there's a bias involved in that. However, when we compare that to the experience of the natural beauty, we see that there's no bias because there's no human angle. It's direct, this direct experience. So you have nature, it's a direct experience, it's not contained, it's vast and open. And the other thing is the difference in the feeling. When you are in nature, there is the phenomena of it, the fact that it makes you feel small. And so we could argue, one could argue that exposure to natural beauty is objective for the various reasons that I mentioned, and exposure to man-made beauty is subjective for the reasons that I just offered. That being the case, when we are exposed to natural beauty, which is objective, what we can say is that we experience something called awe. And by the way, the idea of natural being unbiased, this is something that marketers make use of all the time. So when you're about to buy cereal, there is natural cereal, which a person intuitively assigns this idea of, okay, well, it's natural, so therefore it's good, it's wholesome, it's unbiased, right? And so something that's natural is good for me. And of course, like I said, marketers know this, so that's why cereal is labeled as natural. Or, you know, you have certain types of coffee that's natural, or, you know, some sort of food that is natural, as opposed to being, you know, having a human angle or a human bias or, you know, a human aspect to food, which we would call processed. So something that's really processed is nasty, it's not good. We have this intuitive kind of, we have this intuitive sense that comes out to kind of say, no, I don't want overly processed food, because there's a human element of, you know, chemical processing that's happening. Whereas something that's natural, oh, that must be good for me because it's natural. In other words, there's no bias. Now, we've understood the idea of natural beauty of being objective and you know, human beauty and composition being subjective. If that's the case, returning back to what we had said in terms of our thesis now. Remember, our original thesis was the greater your exposure to beauty, the greater your ability to see truth as it really is. Now, when someone is exposed to beauty, there's a certain experience that they have. Remember, we said that one of the elements of natural beauty is that it makes you feel small. And here we're talking about things like mountains and waterfalls and things like that. It makes you feel small. And part of that feeling, of that idea of feeling small, has to do with a certain phenomena called awe. In the next episode, we're going to be looking at the concept of awe, having a deeper discussion and expounding upon the phenomena of awe and how it relates to beauty and how it relates to our thesis. Again, the more someone is exposed to beauty, the greater they are able to see truth as truth really is, So, with that said, until the next episode, this is Fahad Taslim, and these are Sapient Thoughts.